Okay, welcome guys. Today we are going to continue with the direct titration. We are going to handle a slightly different problem. The last video we checked on how you can be able to standardize solution B, given solution A as the standard solution. To standardize a solution simply means to find the concentration of that solution. This time around we are handling a different problem whereby we are interested in finding the relative atomic mass of X using a titration method. So you're provided with two solutions, solution P and solution Q. Solution P is 0.187 molar hydrochloric acid. Solution Q contains 5.3 grams of a certain metal carbonate dissolved in 500 centimeters cubed of distilled water. And your objective in this experiment is to find the relative atomic mass of X. So a titration experiment was conducted using methyl orange as the indicator. And that table shows the results that were obtained during the experiment. It is important for you to realize that this table has also been completed using one decimal place and that correct arithmetic has been done. Very, very careful, very careful when you're doing your experiments. So we go straight to the questions, and the first question tells us to find the average volume of solution P used. When we refer back to the table, you should be careful to note that this time round, we are not going to consider that figure during our calculation. And the reason as to why I'm not going to consider that figure in my calculation, it is because the value is outside my range. The values to be averaged must be within a range of plus or minus. They must be within a range of plus or minus 0.2. If you look at 27.0 and 26.7, the gap is around 0.3. If you look at 27.0 and 26.6, the gap is around 0.4, so it's outside the range. But if you take these two values, then you realize that they only have a gap of 0.1. And so those two values qualify to fall into a calculation of calculating the average volume. So in this case, this time around, my average volume is going to be 26.7 plus 26.6. And you divide that one by 2 because you have only taken two values to be average, 26.7 plus 26.6, and you divide that one by 2, and this one gives you 26.65 centimeters cubed. Remember again last time we say that when you're doing your calculations you go to two decimal places. When I look at the next question, the next question requires me to calculate the number of moles, the number of moles of solution P that I used. Let me see if there is some information that I have about P. And I think I've been told P is 0.187 molar hydrochloric acid. The moment you have the molarity of a solution, then it should be quite easy for you to calculate the number of moles of that solution. In that case, we are going to be using this formula. Moles is equal to molarity, since we have the molarity of that solution, multiplied by the volume. We should be very careful again to note that the volume of that solution is the one that we calculate as the average volume. Divide this figure by 1,000. And so the molarity is 0.187 multiplied by the volume. The volume, we already got it in our previous part, and we got the volume as 26.65, and you divide this one here by 1,000. Some computation on that, maybe using your calculator, it should be able to give you 0.00494, which you can just round off to maybe 0.005 moles. It will still give you some good accuracy as far as doing the calculations is concerned. We go straight to the next question, and the next question now shifts our attention to solution Q. Let's see if we have the molarity of solution Q. Let's see if we have that one in our information. And I think we have not been given anything about solution Q. We are only told that it's 5.3 grams of a metal carbonate dissolved in 500 centimeters cubed of distilled water. That information is not enough for us to be able to calculate the number of moles. And so what do we do in this case? Here we write first of all the equation. We do the equation
for the reaction between Q and P. Remember, Q was a carbonate, so X2CO3, you don't know what carbonate it is, could be sodium carbonate, could be potassium carbonate, could be lithium carbonate. So plus our solution P is hydrochloric acid, and this one gives me X chloride. Again, check the valences. From this formula here, you can easily realize that X is valence 1, because these two here must have come from the valency of the oxidation number of the carbonate ion, the carbonate radical. The oxidation number of the carbonate radical here. So clearly here you can see that the oxidation number of X is going to be 1 from this formula. And chloride is also oxidation 1, so that gives me the formula X chloride plus water plus carbon 4 oxide. This one is the reaction between a carbonate and an acid. It gives you a salt, water, and carbon 4 oxide. The state symbols, they are all solutions. This is aqueous. This one is also aqueous. This one is aqueous. This one is liquid, and this one is going to be a gas. You do the balancing. The balancing would require that I put here a 2, and that demands that I put here also a 2. And I think my equation is now balanced. So how does this help me? How does this equation help me get the moles? How does that equation help me get the moles? You realize that you had already calculated the moles of solution P. This is solution P, this one is solution Q. So you had already done the moles of solution P, and you found it to be 0.005 moles. So using these moles and this equation, you can now use the mole ratios to calculate the moles of solution Q. And so by using the mole ratios, you realize that 1 of Q requires 2 of P. So 0.005 of P would require how much? You just do some simple cross multiplication, and you realize it becomes 0.005 multiplied by 1, and you divide this one by 2. And that will take you to 0.0025 moles. So now you have used the mole ratios together with the number of moles that you found in part 2 to compute the number of moles of solution Q that you are able to use in that experiment. We proceed to the next question, and the next question now asks us to find the number of moles per liter, the number of moles per liter, the number of moles of solution Q per liter. Now you go back and you realize that in this experiment you use 25 centimeters cubed of solution Q. That's what you used, 25 centimeters cubed of solution Q. You pipetted that, 25 centimeters cubed of solution Q. Now these 25 centimeters cubed, they were equivalent to 0.0025 moles. That's the number of moles that you found in your part 3. So 25 centimeters cubed were equivalent to 0.0025 moles. But this time round, you are being asked about 1 liter. Remember that 1 liter is 1,000 centimeters cubed. So you can comfortably say, if 25 centimeters cubed would produce 0.0025 moles, what about 1,000 centimeters cubed? So again here, you just need to perform cross multiplication, and you realize that this is going to be 0.0025 multiplied by 1,000, and you divide this figure here by 25. Once you compute that, it should take you to 0.1 moles per liter, which you can just call 0.1 molar in the same interpretation. So 0.1 molar or 0.1 moles per liter is the same thing. So molarity is simply the concentration of a solution in moles per liter. Molarity is simply the concentration of a solution in moles per liter, which we have been able to compute in that case. We proceed to the next question, and the next question requires us now to calculate the concentration of solution Q. Calculate the concentration of solution Q in grams per liter. The concentration of solution Q in grams per liter. Quickly referring to what we know about solution Q, we have been told that solution Q contains 5.3 grams in 500 centimeters cubed. So this information will help me. I'll just need to step that
a value up. It's quite easy. 5.3 grams in 500 centimeters cubed. So what about in a liter? That's the question I'm going to be asking myself in that case. So I'm going to ask myself if 5.3 grams prepared 500 centimeters cubed. Then what about a liter? A liter is simply 1,000 centimeters cubed. By cross multiplication, we realize it's going to be 5.3 multiplied by 1,000, and you divide this figure here by 500. So that gives you 10.6 grams per liter. 10.6 grams per liter. I also want you to realize that concentration can now be expressed in two ways. You can express concentration in grams per liter, like you have done in this question, and in the previous question, question 4, we expressed concentration in moles per liter. So we have got those two notations. We have got the concentration in moles per liter and the concentration in grams per liter. That takes me to my next question, question number 6, that is now asking me to calculate the relative formula mass of X2 carbonate, or X carbonate, the relative formula mass of X carbonate. We can use this formula, molarity, since we have the molarity of Q, and remember X2 carbonate was actually Q, don't forget that. Molarity is equal to concentration in grams per liter divided by the relative formula mass. We can use that formula. Since we have molarity of Q, we have that. We have the concentration in grams per liter of Q. We have already solved that. Now, we can use those two values to get the RFM. And you realize now, in this case, the RFM is going to be, we can just substitute molarity was 0.1 molar. You can remember that from one of our previous questions, which is going to be called concentration in grams per liter, that is 10.6. That one is in question 5, you can refer that. Divide by the RFM. And on some rearrangement of that, you realize that the relative formula mass is going to be 10.6 divided by 0.1, which gives you 106. Okay, so we come to our last question that requires us now to meet the objective of our experiment, and we are supposed to be getting the relative atomic mass of X. So we have just seen that in question 6 that the relative formula mass of X carbonate is 106. And so when I want to find the relative atomic mass of X, I've been told carbon is 12 and oxygen is 16. So I can simply say 2X plus 12 for carbon plus, you know, I'm putting 2X here because we have got 2X's here, X2, so that's why it's 2X here, plus 12 plus 3 oxygens, 3 multiplied by 16. 1 oxygen is 16, so 3 by 16. And this should give me 106. That should give me 106. So with some computation here, you realize that 2x plus 60 is equal to 106. Take that 6 to the other side, you realize that 2x is going to be equal to 46, implying that x is going to be equal to 23. And you have been able now to find the relative atomic mass of X as asked in the previous question. You can just write 23, you don't have to put a point, but you can still put a point, 23.0 grams, no problem. It's still the same value. So you have now been able to meet the objective of your experiment, which was to determine the relative atomic mass of X. So those questions can just be compressed into one question as depicted in the assignment. If you look at my assignment, you're not going to go through a series of all those steps. There are no questions to prepare you for the final step. But it's supposed to be on the part of the student to realize that in order for you to go and get the relative atomic mass of X, then you need to go through all those questions that you have solved right from part 2, question 2, going all the way to question number 7. So this assignment, you can copy it down, solve it, make sure that you get the relative atomic mass, sorry, the relative molecular mass as 138 for the M carbonate, and that will give you a value of m as 39. So it's just a practice question. Go through it, take yourself through those stages, and see if you're going to end up in those results. Feel free to leave a comment. If you find any challenge, I'll be there to help. Thank you so much.